Good evening and welcome to our Bible study this Wednesday night, November the 3rd, 2021. Our first Bible study in the month of November, and we're starting a new chapter in Judges chapter 2 tonight. And you probably already have seen that, but in case you haven't, you'll know that. And so if you want to have your Bible handy or your device and be there in Judges chapter 2. As you can see the shot out here, you can probably guess we are in our new church building, and I'm standing in what will become my office. Right now you can see through the walls, you can see behind me and see the kitchen, even the hood that hadn't been put up over the stove yet, and different things. But I want to go ahead and come out here. I enjoy getting to be able to record out here and just get to go through these Bible studies together, as very soon we'll be able to do these Bible studies from here in the finished product, finished building, but all in the Lord's timing. But glad you're joining me. And tonight, as you saw, you may have seen that the title is Israel Rebuked. We are in Judges chapter 2, and we're going to be looking at verses 1 through 5 tonight. Now, in Judges 1, we saw the people of Israel chose to deliberately obey God, but only partly, which, as we know, is disobedience. But rather than following the Lord wholeheartedly, they compromised on several occasions in several ways. They compromised, and because of their disobedience, they are visited by the angel of the Lord here in the beginning of chapter 2. So let's read this together. I'm reading from New American Standard. Whatever passage you or translation you are using, that will work fine as we read this together. Follow along with me, and let's look at the word together. Now the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim, and he said, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land which I have sworn to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And as for you, you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars. But you have not obeyed me. What is this you have done? Therefore I also said, I will not drive them out before you, but they will become as thorns in your sides, and their gods will be a snare to you. When the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the sons of Israel, the people lifted up their voices and wept. So they named that place Bochim, and there they sacrificed to the Lord. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we do come to you tonight. We thank you so much for the opportunity we have to study your word together. I pray that you will search all of our hearts afresh and anew. If there's any unclean way in us, Lord, I pray that you will reveal that to us so we can confess our sins and ask for your forgiveness. And Lord, we thank you that you do give us that forgiveness that you promise as we confess you are faithful and just to forgive and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And we thank you for doing that. We don't want anything hindering our spirits being able to hear your spirit, or as we study your word, that we will be able to hear you speak through it. And I pray, God, that you will just speak through me, that you'll help me die to myself so that you can use me as your vessel in the way that you want to bring you glory give us understanding. Lord, so we give you this time and pray that you will just guide it and direct it and use it all for your glory. And may we be listening as your spirit speaks. It's in Jesus' name we do pray. Amen. Well, again, we are here in chapter 2. And this chapter, basically, as we come to it, closes the period of conquering to possess the land. Israel has done what they were going to do for that. So that has been accomplished. And the opening of chapter 2 is very sobering. Of course, as we read this together, you can quickly see what is taking place. It is difficult to read and difficult to hear, even for us. But then think about how the children of Israel must have felt when it was spoken to them. I remember as a child when I would either do something I was not supposed to do, or I would do something I would not do something that I was told to do. I felt terrible when I had to face my parents and hear the disappointment in their voices or see the disappointment in their faces as they address the situation with me. That was worse than the spankings that I got, sometimes that I might receive because of those actions or inactions. But that disappointment in my parents, I never wanted to disappoint my parents. Here, Israel has disappointed God, disappointed their God. They're having to face him now and hear and see the disappointment in his voice and his disappointment in them. So let's look at the verses together, this passage, each of the verses a little closer and see what all is taking place and what's going on. So back in verse 1 and verse 2 here, now the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim, and he said, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land which I have sworn to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And as for you, you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars. But you have not obeyed me. What is this you have done? Notice when he says, the angel of the Lord. Now, we understand that that is Jesus. It's known as a Christophany, a pre-incarnate manifestation of Jesus showing up in the Old Testament narrative, okay? Before he actually became a man upon this earth in the New Testament times, when he would come and visit the earth as Jesus, he was known as the angel of the Lord. So it's not just an angel. This is God himself. He is speaking in first person, as you notice. And he says, I brought you up out of Egypt and led you into the land which I have sworn to your fathers. So this solidifies that this is God speaking. He is the one who is visiting Israel and speaking to them. It's no mere angel, okay? And no angel would speak this way. He would not speak in first person, only the angel of the Lord, which is the pre-incarnate Jesus. So he reminds them, as he does this, as he speaks to them, that it was he who brought them out of Egypt, okay? He is the one who freed them from bondage. He is the one who delivered them out of the land of pagan religions and oppression. He is the one who has led them to the land they now possessed. He is the one who has given it to them. And it was the land that he had promised to their forefathers, to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Okay? It was the covenant that God had made with them. And he promised he would never break that covenant. He would be their God and would continue to provide for them. But there were stipulations. Israel had to follow his commands. That was their part of this covenant. And then in verse 2, he says, you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. Well, what did we find out that they did back in chapter 1? They did exactly that. They made covenants with some of the people that lived in that land, the Canaanites. God had said, do not do that, and they had done that. Dr. Tony Evan writes, a covenant is a bond. Entering one is like being glued together with that other party. God had made a covenant with Israel, and one of its stipulations was that they were not to make a covenant with the inhabitants of Canaan. Instead, they were to destroy their altars and gods. To make a treaty with Canaan, in fact, was to make, sorry, I'm having trouble getting my page turned here, was to make a covenant with their gods. That's a pretty big statement there. He continues, the native inhabitants of Canaan were not mere people. They were people wholeheartedly connected to a worldview that contradicted the God who had delivered Israel. This is the principle behind the Apostle Paul's words, don't become partners with those who do not believe. We find that in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 14. It says, being a partner is a bond of equality. But there can be no true equality between one who worships the true Creator and one in league with his competition. Then he goes on, he says, you shall tear down their altars. Israel had sins of commission and sins of omission. They did things they were told not to do, and they did not do the things that they were told to do. Here they were supposed to destroy the false religions of the peoples there, all the altars and the different things where they would worship these false gods. They were not to be allowed to remain for any reason at all. And these were heathen nations. Their religious practices and sacrifices were detestable to God. Okay? They were an abomination to him. And he did not want them to continue, and definitely did not want Israel to see them and then start following in those practices and worshiping those false gods. Then we come to where he says, but you have not obeyed me. So you were supposed to go in and wipe them out, not making any covenants with any of the people there, and you're supposed to tear down the altars, get rid of that horrible religious practices of those false gods that were those Canaanites were involved in. And then he says, but you have not obeyed me. That's quick and to the point. As parents, you know, we probably have said that to our children at one time or another. But here, what's worse, this is God, the one who has done so much for this people. He never broke a promise with them. He never let them down. He had given them so much and done so much for them, and he was ready to do more, but they did not obey. Remember, incomplete obedience is disobedience. They had compromised, and he comes in, he says, you have not obeyed me. We saw as we studied in chapter 1, and we looked back to Exodus and Deuteronomy, where God had instructed them on what they were to do and were not to do. We looked at that last time we were together in chapter 1, and it was very clear there in that passages of Exodus and Deuteronomy that this is what you are to do, this is what I will do for you, and these are the things you are not to do. And yet they still rebelled. Was it because of unbelief? Maybe. Maybe they didn't believe that that God would actually do what he said he would do. I don't know. Or it could have been just downright rebellion. They did not follow through with what God had told them. It did not follow through completely. And they chose to disobey. So he says, what is this you have done? Why did you disobey? Why have you done this? Jesus asked this question. There is no justifiable answer to this question. There's nothing that Israel can say, well, we did it because of this, and that's why it's okay. There's no justifiable answer. Maybe they were scared. Maybe they didn't believe that God could actually do all that he said he would. Maybe they thought they were smarter than God and followed their own flawed logic and plans. And maybe they liked the Canaanites, their culture, their religion, their ways, and they decided to join in. Why or whatever it was, they disobeyed. And God confronts them and asks them, why? Why would you do this to the God who loves you? Why would you do this to the God who has saved you? Why would you do this to the God who has rescued you? Why would you do this to the God who has given you everything you need? Why would you do this to the God who has provided a land flowing with milk and honey for you? Why would you do this to the God who has provided homes, vineyards, cisterns for you that you did not have to build? Why would you do this to the God who has made his covenant with you? Now comes his judgment. Look at verse 3. His righteous retribution. Therefore I also said, I will not drive them out before you, but they will become as thorns in your sides, and their gods will be a snare to you. I will not drive them out before you. No longer will God destroy their enemies. No longer will God remove them from their land. They will remain. They will become as thorns in your sides. Just as he had warned them, if they did not do what he said, the Canaanites would be a major problem for them. Thorns, if you think about it, they're just such a nuisance. When you're trying to clean out a flower bed or anything around your yard, thorns, when you're pulling them up, they stick in you, they stab you, they scratch you. And then when you're pulling them out, ripping them out, they're grabbing hold of the good plants and the good leaves and tearing them. It's just a mess. And then you come back a couple of months later and they're all back again because they're just, they never go away. You can rip them up even from the roots, and for some reason, there's always a root still in there. Thorns are just a nuisance, and they hurt when you get stabbed by them, when they scratch you. They are just a nuisance, and you can't get rid of them. The Israelites are now had to put up with these neighbors of theirs that were thorns in their side. Any kind of a bad thing you can think about, a thorn, a thorny bush, a thorny vine, anything like that, that you have to put up with, that's what these Canaanites were becoming to them. They were thorns in their sides. And God had warned them, if they didn't get rid of them and destroy them like he had told them, drive them out, they would become thorns in their sides. And now God is saying, they will be the thorns for you. And then he says, their gods will be a snare to you. Now, here's the real problem, okay? Now these false gods of their thorny neighbors are going to trip them up as they try to follow the one true God. They're going to get in the way. They're going to, now the Israelites are going to be hearing different teachings on life and who provides for them, how you are to worship other gods, and how you are to live your lives in ways to please them instead of pleasing the one true God. They're going to hear conflicting ideology. They're going to be hearing just false teachings of all types. And it's going to trip them up. It's going to cause confusion. It's going to be difficult to discern what is right and what is wrong now. These false gods are going to be a snare to them. They are going to trip them up and cause problems. All because they chose to disobey, to compromise their faith, to compromise on obeying God, only obeying him partially instead of fully. Doing parts that they wanted to do, but not doing the other parts that weren't so pleasant. And now they're going to have to face the consequences. Look at verse 4 and 5. When the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the sons of Israel, the people lifted up their voices and wept. So they named that place Bochim. There they sacrificed to the Lord. The people realized their grave mistake. Okay, this is the whole council of Israel. They had all gathered there, and the angel of the Lord came and visited and spoke to them and shared with them. And they had to face the consequences. They had sinned, and the consequences were coming. God will forgive, but the natural consequences of their sins would now come because they had disobeyed the Lord. They had to face the reality of what happens when you disobey God. Now, Bochim, they called it Bochim. It literally means weeping because the people wept. They were convicted of the sin in their lives. The sins that they had committed brought conviction, and they wept and realized where they had messed up. And then notice that last phrase. And there they sacrificed to the Lord. This phrase shows that they had received God's word and taken it to heart. I believe that that's why it is here. It wasn't a pleasant word. It wasn't one that made you feel good. It was one that definitely stomped on your toes. But they understood that it was true. It was a true message. And they had to answer to it. Sacrificing to the Lord after this visit from the angel of the Lord was an act of worship. Okay? They heard the word. They received it. And they responded. And their response was offering sacrifices and worshiping their God. And so they were able to, even though it was difficult, they realized they had messed up. And they basically admitted to that and therefore sacrificed and offered offerings of worship to God. So what do we learn from this passage? Before we start pointing fingers at Israel, let's take a closer look at our own lives. That's what this passage causes us to do. We must fully obey God. So, as we think about that, and not partially obeying as Israel did, but fully obeying as God calls us to do, what are our sins of omission? What are we not doing that God has told us to do? And then what are our sins of commission? The things that we have committed, the things that we have done that He's told us not to do. What has God told us to do? What's He told you to do? Well, we just have to look at God's word, right? What has He commanded us to do? Okay, to love Him, to live our lives for Him, to follow His commands. And what are those commands? What has He told us to do? That's what He's told us to do. It's in His word. What has He told us not to do? Again, it's in His word. And then the question is, are we obeying Him? That's not easy, is it? Are we obeying Him? And are we obeying Him fully? Are we trying to pull a compromise like Israel did? And say, well, I'm going to follow this part, but these other parts, don't know about that. What does God's word say? And are we obeying Him fully? Do you see where you have compromised on God's commands? Sometimes when we look back at our lives, we understand God had told us some things to do and we compromised a little bit. And we may even see where we have suffered the consequences of that compromise, of that disobedience. Here it's easy to look at Israel and point fingers of saying, you should have done this, you should have done that. And yet we're on this side and see all that has taken place in history with God's people and those in the New Testament and trying, striving to follow the Lord. We have all of God's word now. Are we following it fully? Are we obeying Him? Dr. Charles Stanley says in his Life Principle Bible, he says, incomplete obedience is disobedience and has dire consequences. Will we trust the Lord and obey His word even when the going gets tough? Or will we continue to follow our own flawed logic and plans? Our answer will determine whether we ultimately succeed or fail, because we reap what we sow, more than we sow, and later than we sow. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I thank You again for our time together. Pray that You've been able to accomplish in and through me in this study and what I prepared, all that You desired for Your glory. God, it is hard for us to read and hear this. It's hard for us to take as well when that conviction comes upon our own lives. But Lord, we do pray that You will forgive us where we have not fully obeyed You, where we have compromised. in whatever way that is. And Lord, we pray that you will forgive us. And Lord, help us not to fall again in that temptation to compromise. But may we be faithful in following you wholeheartedly. God, I just pray that you'll help us to do that. Thank you again for your word. And be with us as we continue to strive to live our lives for you. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you again for joining me this evening. I hope you've enjoyed the study. Next time, we are going to look at the next five verses of chapter 2, verses 6 through 10. Go ahead and give you that. And we're going to see a huge responsibility that we have. And it's a responsibility that once again, unfortunately, the Israelites failed to do. But it is one that can hit us real close as well. We need to make sure that we don't fail in the same way. Well, until then, I hope you stay safe, stay healthy, and hope that you're able to join us for our worship this Sunday morning at 9:30 as we come together to worship the Lord, either in person or online. We'd love to have you with us. And until then, God bless you.